All right, testing, testing, 1, 2. This is the beginning of the video, everyone. Right, let's get this other camera rolling. Oh, let me just, there we go. All right, let's get some music playing. Audio. 1, 2, 1, 2. Hey, yeah, oh, hey, Robert. Yeah, is it not open? Yeah, just go around the back. Yeah, I left it open and just come upstairs. Okay. That's the neighbor's dog, yeah. She's crazy, but she won't bite you, yeah. I know, she stinks. I mean, a lot of dogs stink, but we still love them. Yeah. All right. Okay, see you soon. Bye. Well, welcome everyone. My name is Evans Nicholson. I'm the host of this podcast session, whatever we're calling this, hang.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah, man. Calling this, yeah, good times.
Good I don't times. Know. Well, the name of this is Give It Up for the Band.
Yeah.
And the subtitle for this episode is One Third of the Five. Can you,
okay.
Can you figure out why, what that's all about?
I mean, it's got some fractions involved. What do you,
yeah.
Yeah.
So one third decimals. Of five is like 1.666. If you're following along, you math.
Oh, right. That's it's the golden ratio.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Is it?
No, it's not. We'll get to that in a minute, okay. But that's the subtitle.
Okay.
Yeah. And so we'll talk. I'm going to introduce you in a minute. But first, I want to talk about what we're trying to do here with this show. So this show is about the band, the backing musicians. Traditionally, they would be called sidemen, right? Which is
yeah.
probably shouldn't say that anymore. But backing musicians,
yeah.
Side people. What do you
yeah,
think?
Yeah, side man. I don't know. I mean, I never really felt too much like a side man in that band, which is probably a good thing. You
right.
Know?
Well, we'll get to that. It's hard to be a side man in a three piece.
Right.
Right. So.
Yeah.
So for those of you who don't know, Ben Folds Five, not five people, actually, three piece trio: Robert Sledge, Darren Jesse, and Ben Folds. Hence the one third of the five subtitle
right.
of the show.
It's, yeah, silly thing to say, but I mean, I think it came from like him wishing he was in the Jackson Five or wishing, you know.
Yeah.
So something.
Dave
like
Clark that. Five.
Not as much, but more Jackson Five. But like, yeah, but he was mowing the yard, which is like the only time he ever mowed the yard, I think, ever when I lived with him, and he was laughing hysterically to himself, and we'd been trying to say, should we be called Ben Folds Three, because the
yeah.
manager wanted his name in the band.
Yeah.
But Juliana Hatfield had the Juliana Hatfield Three. So
right.
he goes, I got it. We could call it Ben Folds Five. And the other two members will be Caleb and God. And I was like, not laughing really, but I was like, that does sound good, but I couldn't yeah. share the joke. I didn't think it was. But
so it was the manager. It was the manager who came up with that?
It wasn't the manager. Ben came up with it, but
oh, Ben
he
right.
wanted Ben's name in the band, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, because that was his first contact, and he saw a lot of promise in the young man. So
yeah,
he was betting on a long solo career.
I think. So, do you remember Andy Church?
Mm-hmm.
Andy and I were in Local 506, and I think you were all there, and we were all seeing a show. I don't remember, and I think he must have known. You or Ben, he was talking to one of you guys, and I think you guys were running names by him or us or something.
Uh-huh.
We're thinking about calling it Ben Folds Five, and we're both like, so there's more? Is this the whole band right
is
here?
Is there a horn
so,
section?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it could be, right? Later yeah. there was, right?
Yeah, there was.
Yeah.
It would have been six, though.
That would have been.
Yeah.
It's hard to change the name of a band.
I know. And then we had string players. It would have been the seven, Ben Folds Seven.
Yeah.
We had four string players at one point.
Cool.
For a tour.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't remember that. Maybe Andy, maybe Ben knew Andy.
How you got the string section, or even having the string section?
At 5 or 6, talking at 5 or 6 at the club. Right. Like, I don't know. Maybe Darren knew Andy or something. I didn't even know of Andy until later.
Yeah. So we'll talk about Ben Folds 5 for sure. And we'll listen to some music. We'll play a game.
Okay.
Okay. And then we're going to play this segment that I call Squirrel, which is all the random stuff that I thought to ask you and talk to you about, because we've been planning this for like a month, right?
Yeah.
So we'll play Squirrel. And then, we'll listen to some music. But one of the things I want to, if you have eyes and ears and you see Robert Sledge play or listen to Robert Sledge, you know that you're a great bass player, right? And you know that you're a good entertainer on stage. You're not boring to watch, right? And you're a sharp dresser when you want to be. So those to me are like obvious things. But what are some things that you think people like that are not those that people should know about Robert?
I practice like crazy. I mean, there's a reason why, like, when I get on stage, I'm so sort of like hyped up and kind of energetic. I'm ready to do this thing that I've been thinking about a whole lot. And I mean, that's not different than most people. I mean, most people kind of like practice a lot. But when I say I practice a lot, I mean, I practice like
obsessively.
I think about this stuff like a whole lot. But I mean, also, there's lots of little technical things that I kind of try to put into shows and into recordings and stuff. When I have enough time to really grab people's ears, and it may seem like these sort of arbitrary choices or just like things done in the moment, but I do have this sort of like little list of things that I like to
like
maybe
a method.
Yeah, well, just stuff that if I can accomplish it, I will. You know, like copying the melody of the vocal for a minute.
Yeah,
you know, is a big thing that so you have this parallel melody thing happening. Like, and it seems to take over the band for a minute, and you can visibly see people go like, what is going on? Right.
Yeah.
Like that. And like singing like really high harmonic sounding background vocals, you know? Yeah. Stuff like that. And I do that kind of stuff live too, but just things to sort of like to share the spotlight and to grab people's attention. Yeah. I'm just constantly trying to do that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that it feels like a balanced show. Every member of the band is doing something.
Yeah. 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 Jump out in the spotlight and then step back.
Right.
Right.
I mean, and write it into the music. Make sure that it's written into the music.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So when you're creating it, you're doing that. It's not just like you're taking some regular bass line and I'm going to do this now. And then like.
Right. I mean, you can see the lead singer, like, or the whoever. You can see him kind of relax for a minute because this whole other side of the stage is literally carrying the tune. If it's an amicable thing, if they don't feel like they're being upstaged, I have met a couple of people who sort of act that way.
Yeah.
Because they want to carry the whole show the whole time, but it's like, you don't really need to do that. I mean, I think you need to give the audience a break for a minute.
Yeah.
You know?
So, here's the things that I've noticed about you, and you may not, I think you have to have worked with you to know this. Like if you go see you at a show, you're not going to know that Robert shows up prepared, shows up on time, shows up sober.
Yeah.
And you've done your homework, right? And that just goes to what you just said, practicing. So, but you also, you have options, right? You don't come in and say like, okay, I hear your bass part. You know, I'm thinking when you're learning somebody else's tunes, right?
Right.
You don't come in and say, hey, I learned the part, but I want to change it. But I know that I can tell that sometimes when people want to change it, you can go there. You know, you're flexible. Yeah. You're not stuck with the part is what I mean. You know?
Yeah.
So those are the things that I've noticed about you, you know. And so my question is like, so that's being like a professional, right? And being prepared. So is that something that you saw somebody do early on, or like was 20-year-old Robert also always prepared, or did you just grow into it or what?
Yeah, I definitely grew into it. I think it came from, a lot of it came from the pressure from Ben Folds 5, but you know, just sort of having to be on and ready and never ever taking the gig for granted, you know.
Right.
Once I had a real gig, you know, it was like, well, scrapping. I can't take this for granted. And this is something I've never had, you know. Yeah. This touring situation, a recording situation, or a relationship with a record label. And I was like, this is great. So I think after that experience, I definitely wanted to be more prepared. But I don't know. I just get more. I get more and more prepared, like all the time. I kind of feel like I'm just kind of upping my game all the time.
Yeah.
And I feel responsible to the. Like I don't want to waste people's time. That's a big thing. I don't have that much time, and I don't want to waste anybody's time. But you know, when I hear other people podcasting about being professional guitar players or something, you know, people way above my pay grade, they like, that's exactly, they're talking about the exact stuff that I do.
Right.
You know?
Right. Yeah.
But I've learned systems of charting of like, I can chart a couple of different ways, a few different ways, and accomplish things relatively quickly and be prepared. And I actually really enjoy that. I really enjoy charting. Maybe that was the short answer.
Yeah. And we're back.
Hey.
Today's broadcast is... Oh, did I tell you? So today is the first episode, right?
Yeah.
Today's the first episode. If there's another second episode, there's no other episode, this is the pilot.
Yeah.
And this will be the only one. So
okay.
It remains to be seen what will happen.
Oh, it's going to be really successful, and you're going to have lots of people to interview.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I hope to.
You know, it's funny about... Like, you were talking about being professional earlier... And my gear, like, I never wanted to spend any money or ever have any debt.
Yeah.
You know, when I just didn't have any money when I was young.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I didn't have any money until I was like 26 years old, you know. I mean, my parents weren't poor or anything, but I just didn't want to commit to having a credit card or having a job, really, you know, or having anything.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, I did have jobs, but I didn't want to have too much of a job. You know,
yeah.
To most of the gear that I had when I was younger was stuff that I threw together or bought really cheap and fixed, you know?
Yeah.
So I never, you know, I never had like an acoustic stack or, you know, an Ampeg stack. I didn't have anything like that until I was like professional and endorsed,
right.
You know?
It helps when other people are helping you pay for it.
Or, right. That's right. I mean, I never had a bass. I mean, I used to say that I never had a bass that cost more than $70 until I was like, you know, in Ben Folds 5. That's not totally true. I did have...
So you're saying you lied when you said that before?
I just forgot about these Fenders. I had a succession of Fenders that I had bought. I bought like a Fender jazz bass because I just liked how jazz basses looked always, and I always imagined myself playing one.
Plus it sounds cool.
Playing
the jazz.
They sound... I mean, yeah. I mean, like, but it was never my sound. I could never really get my sound on a jazz bass. But like a PJ bass is more my thing. That's what I like, a PJ. But I had like at the end of Toxic Popsicle, I had this red jazz bass, which I sold. And then like this guy, Bobby Kelly, he's this really nice guy.
Oh, I know Bobby Kelly. Yeah, he was
a big part of the Greensboro
Mafia
thing. Yeah, in the 90s, you know, Bobby Kelly. And, you know, later too, but he's, you know, he's still around.
The Boogie? Wasn't he involved in the Boogie?
I think so.
I know he played the Boogie all the time.
Tornado with Sam Fraser, you know.
He was in the Wicked Mojos with me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Bobby Kelly?
He was the first
Bobby
bass player.
Kelly?
Yeah.
Bobby, man, he had such a good sound. He was such a chill dude, such a good sound.
You know, Bobby, so playing the blues, and you know this, when you're playing a shuffle, I think it's Mark Simonson calls it the freak out mode. When you're shuffling and you're on your third chorus of a solo, there's been back and forth guitar, harmonica, and you're just shuffling. I get in freak out mode sometimes. I'm like, I've got to do something else. Like,
right.
I can't.
Oh my
God, I'm about to. Right. And so I would just shake it up a little bit.
Yeah.
And Bobby would just, nope, don't do that. don't shake it up.
You know?
He taught me to just fight the freak out mode and just stay the course.
Oh my God. I can't do it though. I can't, I have to go like, I always think of it as me blowing off steam. Cause I do get really frustrated. You know, I feel like I'm not moving the music along. I feel like I'm not moving humanity along.
Well, that's not your job in that band.
So I'll go, you know, that's what I always do. Something like that.
Does the guitar player go,
you know, somebody does something, you know, but I've learned to tame those. I've learned to be more artful about that kind of stuff. I know how to do it in a way that satisfies both me and the song.
So you know? Rob Ladd said that at the end of the shows, when he'd play these super straight maybe it was Don Henley, the end of the Van Halen ending, you know, that was like his one time to play some chops, just get them all out, because this is it, you know?
Yeah. Oh, man. Yeah, those big, is my collar up? My collar was still up.
It's the those way you're rolling.
Big shows, those big shows like that where everybody expects the record to be played.
Right.
You know, that would be tough. I've seen so many of those cats who are well-known, like they're well-known side men. I see it in their eyes that they are like in jail or something. They captured. They can't change. You know, they don't want to get fired. They like their status, you know, but I can tell that they're just a little bit like, oh, dear Lord, I wish I could reinterpret what I'm having to do right now.
So you see a little, like they see you looking at them and they have this like, help me.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Playing the record.
What's his name? Oh, God. Jason Sheff. Is that his name? The guy? I'm terrible. He played in Chicago for a long time. It was Jerry Sheff.
Chicago.
Jerry Sheff's son. Jerry Sheff, the bass player, famous bass player. His son is a great singer and a great bass player, and he can play and sing bass really well, which is a really hard thing to do.
And you've been practicing that?
What? Dang. Hey. No.
So, no? No. I think Chicago's great, man. It always...
They're pretty good. I hadn't thought about them.
Yeah, I haven't either until recently. It threw me off, though, because Chicago, I don't know why, but I just... Their logo, when I like it, just the first time I heard it, I'm like, that's not what I thought it was going to be. I don't know if it was just the frilliness of the word, or it just, do you know what I'm saying? Like, maybe
what did you think it was going to be?
I don't know. I like more showy or something. Like, it looked like their logo looked like a Broadway musical or something. It just looked theatrical. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know what you're saying. I kind of trying to remember. I felt that same
thing. It's got a big C and it's real ornate looking, maybe.
Yeah, I mean, at the time, considering other graphics, it did seem a little misleading. I wanted, like, when they were all like spilling paint and they're up on the scaffold that's, you know, half fallen down and stuff, you know, that picture, the greatest hits picture. Yeah, it was just like, it was hard to reconcile their sound with that image. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, so there were some mismatches, but great band. So I guess we should talk about Ben Folds.
Yeah, sure.
Five?
Ben Folds 5. Oh, you don't want me to specifically talk about?
Well, whatever.
So he would wake up in the middle of the night naked and he always had to go to the bathroom naked. He only composes naked. No, that's a lie.
You heard it here first.
That's all a lie. I'm sorry.
So tell me about, like I said, the first time I met you guys or heard about you was in 506, which you clearly don't remember, which pisses me off.
I meet so many people.
God. At that point, actually, the first time I met you, let's just backtrack a little bit, was actually fast forwarding because you were already playing with Ben. And I think you were doing sound at 506. Maybe you were, Brian Settle was there. Maybe you were filling in for Brian. That's also where I met Brian.
Okay.
But anyway, and I was bitching about bringing in like another case or something, and you're like, we got to carry around a piano.
Yeah,
we were just like, okay, I don't feel so bad anymore.
Right.
That was the first time I think I met you. So,
oh, well.
For real. But so just quickly, because I haven't heard the story, how'd you guys meet? I know Darren was in Greenville. You mentioned that. And Ben is from?
Winston,
okay.
But he went to UNCG in Greensboro.
Okay. Yeah. So, how did that go down?
Oh, well, I mean, you know, we all met each other sort of well after college, and everybody was just trying to make it as a player.
Yeah.
And we all were, we weren't free. Darren was in Howtown with Dave Wright, but I...
Howtown? You just remembered the name.
No, that was a different band.
It was
a different band. It was a... wasn't the Easily Swayed, it was some other thing.
Anyway,
I had just got back from a trip to Nashville with my friends. We were all at this sort of impasse, like, well, we need to do something. My friends had made these my friend Keith Brogdon and Elliot Wilcox had just made this connection with this band in Nashville, and they wanted to hire those guys, my friends, and to come to Nashville. So I was like, okay, I'm going to go to Nashville with y'all because y'all are like my best friends. And so Toxic Popsicle had just broken up. And so I'm like, okay, I'm gonna follow you guys to Nashville. I was like, Nashville, once I was there, I was like, well, at the time, and this is 1993, it's not my favorite place in the world. There's a whole bunch of weird stuff here, but there's a whole lot of musicians here. So
yeah,
maybe I'll try this. So I got back and I was ready to go. I got back from that trip and I was ready to pack up and move to Nashville. And Ben had called. There was a message on my answer machine from Ben Folds, and I thought it was a joke. I thought it was some friend of mine playing a joke. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I called him back, and I thought he was kidding. I didn't think I was good enough to play with Ben.
Yeah.
You know, because I just thought I was like this sort of hard rock kind of thrash funk
with your
loser.
Round glasses.
You know, because I didn't want to play anything standard. Everything I wanted to be super progressive in kind of an abstract, kind of arty punk rock way. I didn't want anything to be, you know, traditional at all. And Ben was just so far ahead of me musically that I just was like, I didn't think I could do it. But it turned out to be really a good match, you know, because maybe Ben felt like he needed somebody more edgy to play with rather than, you know, these, you know, music school types and jazz bows that he'd been playing with, you know, who were qualified to play with him, but weren't maybe adding as much to what he want, you know, he wasn't getting anywhere professionally by playing with these people. So.
Right.
So I got this message from him, and he and I started talking, and we were looking for a drummer, and we were just kind of scouting around all these people that we knew. You know, we were just kind of calling anybody that we knew.
You didn't call me.
I didn't know you. And I wish that I had. And that would have been cool. But yeah, and we wanted somebody who sang, and we were looking for a place. He was looking, maybe Ben had gone to Chapel Hill and he was looking for a place, and he rented to Darren on the street. And Darren and he had known each other from Nashville. Darren had lived with Morgan Davis for a short time, which was cool. Yeah. That Darren just sort of had picked up stakes and moved to Nashville when he was young. Darren's younger than me. And so that was impressive that Darren had tried to live in Nashville for a while.
Yeah,
you know?
That's...
And so, you know, Ben and Darren talked, and then next thing you know, we do a rehearsal, and it was obvious like Ben wanted, he liked this lineup. He liked us three together, you know.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say the first rehearsal was like awesome. I wasn't completely convinced. I think I had a different thing in my head, but Ben was really, and I didn't really get much of a sense of Darren at the time, you know, but then I think this was like the second rehearsal. It was really obvious. Like, it's funny. It's like, wasn't magic at first. It wasn't like ZZ Top, you know, where they talk about like jamming for 10 hours.
Right.
After first meeting each other.
I saw that.
Or something like that, you know. Yeah. But with us, it was like, we were just kind of playing Ben's songs because he had this catalog of songs. And that was super fun after years of sort of this grind of me writing songs for Toxic Popsicle and writing lots of riffs and doing all this stuff.
Yeah.
Ben actually had... really well composed songs that he had been turning into for publishing, hoping he had a publishing deal in Nashville. He'd been turning these things in, you know, and performing them. And they were so, so well written, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was just really easy for me to inhabit that role. I loved it, you know.
Yeah. Sweet. Yeah. It definitely, I think you're right about bringing your, like your background and your bass playing to that band, definitely. I mean, as with Darren's drumming, made it something different than it would have been. I mean, that's true with any combination of three people. But I see what you're saying about it could have gone in one direction with, but then you bringing in your own thing and recognizing that, and maybe the fact that it wasn't so like locked in the first time was a good sign because you had to figure some stuff out. Right?
I had to be encouraged by Ben to really step out and do things more Toxic Popsicle. Cause my first instinct was like, oh, listen to the pretty piano. I'm going to compliment that. And Ben sort of has said that I don't really remember saying this, but I'm sure he's right. Like, I wanted to be more jazz.
You did?
Yeah, I just kind of, but then I'm not very jazz. anybody who is jazz knows that I'm not that jazz. And
but everybody wants to be jazz. Yeah, that's the thing. That's what we strive for. It's supposed to be the highest art, right?
Right, I mean, but it's not. But, you know, I'm just this knucklehead rock musician that's good at that. I'm good. Like, that's a thing I'm good at. It's like, it's, you know. Like,
knucklehead rock.
Yeah, knucklehead rock, you know. Just really emotional riff rock, you know, kind of really fast emotional riff rock. Uh-oh, you got an internet deal, AT&T internet. Okay, it's dismissed. But so...
Wait, I got to go fix my internet deal. I'm going to lose $30 if we don't go. You got to
get Amazon, AT&T. So, so he said, so I was definitely encouraged to kind of be more aggro, you know, as a contrast against this, this piano. And he was trying to be... he didn't have to try too hard to be more intense. He's just a great entertainer, man. I couldn't believe it. Like, the first show we played together.
Yeah.
All the stuff came out of him. Yeah. He was like, it really engaged with the crowd. I remember he's like playing, and he's on the edge of the stage. We're at the Blind Tiger in Greensboro.
Yeah.
And he's playing, and he's over stage right, and he's looking at the audience, and the piano is really like right on the edge of the stage. So he's close enough to where he's trying to get this girl to fake punch him, you know? And I was like, what are you doing? Like, who does that? And it's just like, you know, I usually have a wall between me and the audience, you know?
Right, but he's like, just totally come on in, audience.
Yeah, it was a great show, and everybody loved it. And I was like, wow. You know? Always had some shenanigan like that every show, you know?
Yeah.
Which makes me sort of, I could never do that. I would like get uncomfortable, but... It's amazing. He's just such a good performer.
And we're back. And we're back. So we're going to go through Robert's phone here and play some tunes.
Yeah. So I thought I might play. What's interesting, like, about playing with Ben, you know, and this is prior to the, I mean, after the stuff I'd already done, sorry, prior, after, whatever, I got that confused. But playing with Ben is was different than what I'd done before, because all of a sudden, I felt like in some ways I was inhabiting a role, and I was like serving his songs, you know? So he would write these great bass lines, and I'm like, that's a great bass line, you know?
Right, because he
really liked that. Yeah. And, you know, I didn't think about like the criticism I might get, like, oh man, you're not really writing your own bass lines. I'm like, no, I played the bass line that he wrote because it's awesome, and his song is awesome. So I'm going to play this bass line. So there was an early song called Uncle Walter that... was on her first record, and I think even a student was like, seemed disappointed in me that I didn't write that, because it's such a great line, and but I thought about this for a long time, and I'm like, no, like, if Arthur Miller writes a really good play, you should just say what he wrote.
Yeah, I mean,
you know what I mean, and you will become famous for the person who interpreted that thing. So that's the way I like to think about it, you know.
Yeah.
But that being said, so this is an example of that. So this is Uncle Walter, you know, me playing bass, loving what he wrote, and just the band is killing it. Yeah. Boom, boom, boom. I'm filling up every space I could fill up.
There's no piano here. It's just bass and drums right now.
Oh.
Yeah.
Boom, boom.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, the bass, the kick and the bass are just like...
Yeah, yeah.
So together.
I love that drum set, too, that he's playing.
Yeah.
The, 60s Ludwig.
Yeah?
Yeah.
It's fat.
22.
Yeah?
22.
22 by 14, probably a narrow one.
Yeah. Such great, like, piano, bass, you know, arranging.
Yeah.
You know, and these those kind of changes I'd never played before.
Yeah, everyone had to have their little jazz change after this, you know, and your Latin change.
Right. Yeah, that's right, the Latin thing, I'd never played those 2-5-1s like that.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't understand what 2-5-1 even was back then. Right. You know what I mean? It was that sound. I
thought it was like an area code or something?
Yeah, it was that sound I'd heard people play.
Right, right. Yeah.
It's frantic, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's like it's way it's pushed, but it's not like it's not. It doesn't feel rushed to me, you know.
Right.
Energy versus feeling anxious and rushed.
Right.
You know? Oh yeah.
In the room with my amp.
There it is. That's why people want you to do that sound.
Exactly.
Oh yeah, let's hire this guy. He does this.
Totally got this from Andy West and the Dixie Dregs. This right.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Oh, I know.
Just freaking out.
He's not sitting down at this point.
No, he's kicked the bench behind him.
The bench is gone. We don't know where the bench is.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, see? Oh, yeah. Yeah, killer, man. So, Robert, I want to thank you for coming today.
Oh, my pleasure, Evans. It's awesome.
What do you think of the studio?
You have a great studio.
Well, thank you.
No, I mean, it's nice and cozy, man. It's your rec space.
It is.
I dig it.
So I got three names. You have the honor of naming the studio since you're the guest. Okay, I've got three names for you that I've thought about, all right?
Okay.
First one is E-Sharp Studio for Evans and E-Sharp, which is a drummer joke, which is not a thing, F-flat. Yeah. E-Sharp Studios or the Natural Light Studio. Because here's the tag. Here's
we only have natural light, and that's what y'all are going to drink tonight.
What I was going to say is we have natural light outside, and we have natural light inside downstairs in the fridge if you want to go get one. So that would be okay.
Yeah.
And then the third one is
that sounds like you're endorsed by it.
I know.
It's product owned.
And honestly, I drank a lot of that beer this last week trying to get ready for this. Headache. So I'm not sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay.
So, no natural light sponsorship.
Yeah.
So the third one is, when I built this, this was a pandemic project, but I brought my wife Dana up here and I said, what do you think of my man cave? And she said, this is not a cave. This is like upstairs. This is not a cave.
Yeah.
She said, this is more like a he shed. And so the third name, possible name for the studio is She Said He Shed Studios. So which one is it going to be today?
The name of the studio. She said he shed.
She said he
shed.
You got to practice it a lot.
She said he shed.
Or Natural Light Studios or E Sharp.
I'm more an E Sharp. I think. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
But that's.
Sharp. Yeah. So thank you from E Sharp Studios today, Robert Sledge. Been a pleasure.
Man. Oh, man, I enjoyed it. Thanks, Evans.
Yeah.